This episode is sponsored by BetterHelp. When you feel like your best, ma'am, fam, you can do anything. You can accomplish all those goals in your life, make sure your family's good, and even start, who knows, a mildly successful podcast. Sometimes life gets you bogged down. You might feel overwhelmed. You're not showing up every day the way that you want to. But working with a therapist can help you get closer to the best version of you. Because when you feel empowered, you're more prepared to take on everything that life throws at you. The benefits of therapy are endless. It's great to just check in with somebody who can give you some perspective on life. Make sure that you're meeting all the goals that you've set for yourself in life. So whether or not you've been in therapy, now could be the time to give BetterHelp a shot. It's convenient, flexible, affordable, and entirely online. Just fill out their brief questionnaire. You get matched with a licensed therapist. You can switch therapists at any time for no additional charge. Couldn't be easier. If you want an empowered life, therapy can get you there. So visit betterhelp.com/madaboutmovies today to get 10% off your first month. That's BetterHelp, HELP.com/madaboutmovies.
Ladies and gentlemen, give me that effing hot dog. I'm Kent Garrison.
And I'm Brian Gill.
And this is Mad About
Movies.
Da, 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 da.
You sound insane. You realize that?
Yeah.
The whole world got crazy.
Seriously?
It's showtime.
Mad About Movies is your go-to destination for all things cinema. We give you some movie news, movie rumors, and those all-important movie rumblings in the first half of the show. In the second half of the show, we'll discuss our given movie of the week. Don't be afraid, we'll let you know if there's going to be any spoilers ahead. And at the end of the show, we'll give you our weekly recommends. This week, Kent, we will be talking about which movie?
Black Nativity. Or Out of the Furnace.
You want another?
No. Rodney was supposed to meet me here half hour ago.
Now, why the hell you want to fight?
I just need the money.
You're going to be a good boy and take a dive. I'm not going to have to teach you a lesson.
We should tell the listener this was at least our second choice, if not more. We tried really hard to do Nebraska, and I think we'll get it done eventually. So our listeners should look for that one in the future, but...
It's a pretty good story. Let's go ahead and get the story out of the way right off
the
top.
So we live in the Dallas-Fort Worth Metroplex, as we've mentioned before, and we have been besieged by a winter storm that literally shut down the entire Metroplex for like 4 days, 5 days. I mean, crazy. So Kent, you live close to the only theater in town that was showing Nebraska. I do not. I was going to make it there yesterday, but they literally had every road that I could use to get there shut down. So I had to just bail out, and we ended up seeing Out of the Furnace instead.
Still don't know what the title Out of the Furnace means.
I don't either.
But luckily, I have the movie guru, Brian the movie guy, here with me tonight. Hopefully you can enlighten me on what the title of the movie means.
Right. They should have said it at some point in the movie. Christian Bale should have just muttered to himself, "Out of the furnace, man." Am I right?
It's not entirely out of the question that Woody Harrelson did mutter it to himself. It was just inaudible.
Yeah. Or worse, Whitaker too, with that dark night voice. Yeah.
But we'll get into that a little bit later. But I want to start off the show. I want to cue the music up. I want to start off the show with a shout out. We got an epic email that I had to save. I didn't want to tell you about it until we got on the show. It's from listener Tyler DeLong. So hello, Tyler. He writes, "Hello guys, first time caller, long time listener." Which nice. Okay, it's already awesome.
Sweet ticket reference.
He says, "I think I just got MacGrubered. I've been a fan of this film since day one. But it wasn't until the best Cyber Monday deal ever on Amazon, when MacGruber was on sale for $3, obviously I was all in." So clearly, you all can relate to the joy of when it shows up, knowing that I can procrastinate any future life event with the helping of MacGruber and spring it on friends and family at will. And of course we know how that feels.
Absolutely.
Exactly. Well, I unwrap it and open the case and find no disc inside. It is at this moment.
No! Oh, that's terrible.
That it is completely acceptable for me to let out a Will Forte yell. But I immediately started laughing. Even the process of opening the DVD case to MacGruber is hilarious.
Nice.
This was such a great MacGruber moment for me, and I'm actually sending this email before I begin the process with Amazon to get a new DVD sent. But I believe it was at one of the many important Toretto family barbecues that Dom said, sometimes the best things in life are worth waiting for.
Nice. Nice. I like that guy.
But yeah, thank you, Tyler, for the email.
Yeah, Tyler, you're the man.
I'm glad you could find some common ground with us in our love for MacGruber.
Yeah. I would warn Tyler, though, you can't really procrastinate too long by watching MacGruber. It takes about 27 minutes to get through the whole movie, so... You might want to add in like the entire Fast and the Furious franchise to make sure you really, really can procrastinate the right way, I would say.
Exactly. It's like, what are you going to do? Watch another episode of The Walking Dead or watch MacGruber again?
Right. Yeah.
It's usually MacGruber wins out.
That's right. That's right.
Exactly.
You can get through MacGruber twice before you finish an episode of like Sons of Anarchy or... I don't know, Boardwalk Empire or something. So, you know.
Slightly less throat ripping in The Walking Dead. Still throat ripping.
Yeah.
Slightly
some,
less. I prefer some. The MacGruber amount of throat ripping.
Right. Yeah.
In my entertainment. Just,
yeah, right.
But man, Brian, it's good to have you.
Yeah.
Good to have you on tonight.
We're a man down, though. That's,
we are a man down. The Ice Apocalypse 2013 has consumed Richard.
Yep.
But Richard, I will say, like always, every time you miss, just put ointment on it, and you'll be back in no time.
Yeah. Movie news.
Yes!
Rumors and rumblings.
That's awesome!
Let the filibustering begin.
But, Brian, I wanted to ask you, any movie news, rumors, and rumblings that you want to talk about?
Oh, Kit, I wish I could pull out an entire list of topics to delve into, but I sadly have brought absolutely nothing to the table. It's a miracle that I am here this week, as well as Richard missing. So you might have had to do this alone. It's been a crazy week. So yeah. I have nothing, but I'm hoping that you have something you want to talk about.
I do. You did a double feature yesterday, actually.
I did.
You want to talk about that?
Sure. Yeah, the strangest double feature. maybe not ever. I'm certain that I've done a weirder double feature.
I've done a couple weird ones this year. I'll have to think about which ones I've done. But go ahead.
I'm a big fan of the double, even the triple feature. Occasionally, are you in the same boat as me on that?
Yeah. I will do that. It you know, weekends. If the movie's been out a couple weeks, I try to do that because I know I'm never going to have to fight a crowd, so I can schedule it. Three in a row, you know. I usually just try to wait a week or two after a movie comes out before I see it in the theater, because I really don't like fighting a crowd. And there's a chance if you go like at 10 p.m. on a weeknight, for especially a lot of these indie movies, there's a chance you'll have a theater to yourself for like $5 or whatever seeing it. So that's always nice. So I try to do that, but I have done more double features this year than I ever have. Yeah. I think the last one I did was I saw Jobs with Ashton Kutcher.
Yeah.
Followed by You're Next, which was a horror slasher film. And they were both equally scary.
Right.
For different reasons. But I think that was the last one I did. So tell me about your double feature.
Yeah, well, I went to Monday again. Monday was the first day I really got out of the house. I got out for about 30 minutes to an hour on Sunday from... I think Thursday night. So from about from Thursday at about 7 p.m. until Sunday in the late afternoon, I was just in my house with my wife and our infant, who became more and more unhappy with the situation. Anyway, Monday I got out and I went to theater and I saw the movie we're going to talk about in a little bit. And I also saw a heartwarming little cartoon known as Frozen, which is currently the number one movie in the land. And I thoroughly enjoyed it. Very, very good movie. Really, really liked it a lot. Kind of has that, I'm digging the Disney charm that's kind of been refound, I guess, over the last few years. I think we both really liked Wreck-It Ralph last year.
Right.
I thought that was fantastic. And I really, really liked Tangled, which I didn't expect to like. And I think that's a movie that 5 years ago from Disney would have been awful. But under John Lasseter, they're just gotten really good at what they're doing. Anyway, Frozen's kind of, I think Frozen actually takes place in the same universe as Tangled. It's like, okay. Not, there's no characters that overlap or anything, but it's, I think it's supposed to be kind of the same general, world and whatnot, but, man, it's really good. I don't know how many of our listeners who are, like yourself, Kent, who are, you know, males in their mid-20s are going to really love this movie. But, you know, yeah, as an old man...
Does it have that adult appeal that the Pixar films like Wreck-It Ralph had? Like,
I think it does. It's not to that level. Wreck-It Ralph is really a Pixar movie that somehow got made by Disney, I think. This is definitely more of a Disney movie. I mean, it's, you know, it's about a princess. There is songs. Yeah, there's like, it's a musical. So that's clear, you know, that's not everybody. I would not have texted Richard and you and said, hey, you guys need to get out and see this movie immediately or anything like that. I don't know that it's going to be your cup of tea, but man, it's really good for what it is. It's a very good film. I understand why it's been so successful. And also should be mentioned, I'm not the first to say this at all. It's been bandied about on the internet quite a bit, but the marketing campaign for this movie is horrible. Like, I really thought that movie was going to be genuinely a bad movie. It looks really bad in the trailers and all the stuff. So kudos to Disney for putting out a very good movie. Maybe get a new marketing department, because I don't know that it did their film any good making it look like something that we were going to be embarrassed to see.
Sure. I think I've taken a break from Disney the past few years. I'm trying to think about the last Disney movie I actually saw that wasn't Pixar.
Mm-hmm.
As far as animation goes, I never saw Lilo and Stitch. I didn't see Princess and the Frog. I didn't see Tangled.
Mm-hmm.
I'm trying to think, what was before that? It was like Titan or Atlantis.
Yeah.
I did see that. I think Treasure Atlantis, Planet. Treasure Planet was the last one I saw. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, I'm with you. I'd written them off because they've been bad. Lilo and Stitch is okay. I don't mind that one. I actually like The Emperor's New Groove.
Yeah, I do like that one. Yeah. I forgot that was even Disney because was actually really good.
Right. Yeah, that was like 2000, I think. Mm-hmm. That was probably the last one that I really liked. But my wife and I went to see Tangled when it came out, and I was just like, man, this is a Pixar quality, this is Pixar telling a princess story, or Pixar making a Disney movie, you know what I mean? And I know they work together, but it is such a different thing. Anyway, I that's a really good movie. If you have a daughter or something, that's a movie worth watching for sure. And then last year, Wreck-It Ralph was excellent. I think Wreck-It Ralph was in my top 10 of the year. I loved that movie. And then this may find a place in the top 10, honestly. It's really good. Good really? Voice work. You know Josh Gad, who is on Book of Mormon on Broadway?
Yeah, and also in the Jobs movie. Yeah.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Wozniak or whatever. Yeah. Yes. He voices Olaf the Snowman, which, again, is... part of the marketing campaign looks terrible, and he might be the best part of the movie. And he's really good. I liked it a lot, and I'm starting to wonder if, because like the last few years, Pixar has been mediocre, I would say at best, maybe sure. slightly above average. Brave was a good movie. It just didn't have that kind of Pixar magic that you want.
I would say they're playing it safe. It's like they're making movies that are all equally as good as each other. It's
sure.
Like, it's not like they're constantly making a movie that's better than the last one they made, you know?
Right.
Like, I feel like Brave and Monsters U were about, they're okay. They're both fine, you know?
Yeah, sure.
But they're not, they're nothing, they're not breaking any ground for Pixar at all.
Right.
Animation wise, Brave was maybe their best movie though.
Yeah, Brave looked great. Sure,
it did.
Sure, and then Cars 2 was before that. Cars 2 is actually
I didn't even see that. So, yeah,
but my deal is I'm starting to wonder if it's not so much Pixar that's great as it is John Lasseter who's great. Because now John Lasseter is in charge of Disney Animation, and since he came over, they've had four movies since he came over, and it's Tangled, it's Wreck-It Ralph, it's this one, Frozen, and then Mars Needs Moms, which was a holdover from the
previous.
Lasseter
did that?
Well, it came out under his watch, but it wasn't his movie. You know what I mean? It was something that got made, and he just had to release it, basically. So that you can't really even count that one against them. Because Tangled, they put a lot of effort into completely reworking that to make it a good movie. So I'm starting to wonder, like, coming out of this movie, is there going to be a point in the near future, in the next couple of years, where it's not Pixar that is the lead in animation, but it's back to Disney? And is it all because of John Lasseter? I'm really starting to wonder important he is to this process.
That's a good point. Lasseter is definitely the brain behind a lot of Pixar success. I definitely agree with you.
Yeah,
I think the way things are headed, though, I think Pixar and Disney are going to end up being like one and the same anyway.
Sure.
Because Pixar's umbrella is just going to be solid Disney, you know?
Right.
I still see Lasseter going to work on Pixar and Disney. I still see it both ways. And I still see like Andrew Stanton doing both, both too. Like he did John Carter and he did, you know, Pixar as well. So.
Right. Yeah. It's going to be real interesting to see, because I think if you ask the people at Disney, what I'm interested in is there a pecking order now, or is it just, you know, this was developed by Pixar, so it's a Pixar movie, or is Disney going to be poaching those ideas and making them actual Disney properties instead of Pixar Disney properties, you know? Because I would imagine the folks that are straight Disney would rather that the best animated movies come from them rather than Pixar, but Pixar does things. The one thing that this movie lacks personally for me was that kind of classic Pixar animation. It looks like a Disney movie, but it has kind of a Pixar story. I prefer the Pixar animation, so I would have loved for this to have been, you know, to be a Pixar movie. But I guess it doesn't matter. If they're going to put out good movies, then I guess it doesn't really matter whether it's Pixar or Disney. But it's going to be interesting to see how that plays out over the next couple of years with Lasseter and with Pixar really kind of struggling for the first time in their, you know, almost 20-year history.
Yeah, the Despicable Me and some, you know, franchises that aren't Disney and Pixar have sort of taken over. It's kind of interesting to see that happen.
Yeah.
Despicable Me is by far the biggest animation
right
now for kids, I would say.
Yeah.
Those Minion things are everywhere.
Yeah. The interesting thing on that is I'm very interested in and I've said interested 1,000 times, so sorry about that, but I find the animation game very, very interesting because...
Me too, yeah.
Like, Sony and DreamWorks and the other animation studios, they get some of these hits. Cloudy with the Chance of Meatballs was a pretty successful movie, and you're right, Despicable Me is
Ice
huge.
Ice Age is huge, too.
Yeah,
Madagascar, huge.
Right. But for every one of those, they have like three movies that completely are terrible and no kid really ever cares about. And whereas Disney and Pixar too, it's like, well, we're putting out one movie a year. And if it hits, it's going to be a huge hit. And if not, then we're going to catch flack for it. But it's like it's efficiency versus the kind of the shotgun approach of just, well, we're going to put out six movies and we'll see which ones work and which ones don't. But I always find that kind of to be a fascinating phenomenon, or just how that plays out between those studios.
Yeah.
The difference in philosophy, I guess.
So, something that you might be able to enlighten me on as well, Brian, being a dad, like you are, it's always funny to me, the kid movies that come out that have no appeal to adults. And it's just like they only come out because it's a kid's movie, you know, and there's not another kid's movie coming out that weekend.
Yeah. Yeah. You know, are you talking about Free Birds? Yeah.
Yeah. That and like Smurfs 2. Like there's no logic at all used in greenlighting another Smurfs. Like no one needs another Smurfs.
Sure.
And it's just like, well, it's the middle of the summer and your kids are at home crying because they've been home all week because they don't have school. So you're going to go take them to do something. So Smurfs 2 is out. So what's your opinion on movies like that? Have you experienced? I mean, your son's not even a year old yet.
Fortunately,
I haven't experienced it yet. But.
Too much of that. But I do work with kids, and I run a summer program where every year, one of the events, we'll probably do 5 or 6 different events, and I kind of change them out. But usually we end up going to the movies at least once, and I kind of just have to – I mean, sometimes I can, like we went to see Madagascar 3 a couple years ago, and that was all right. There's 3 levels of kids' movies. You have – at the top tier, you have your Toy Stories, and, you know, the best of Pixar, the best of Disney – and a few of those other movies, How to Train Your Dragon, things like that, that appeal to everybody. Like, they're just good movies that happen to be animated, you know, rather than here's an animated movie for your kid to watch while you try not to kill yourself. And then there's the second tier. I would put movies like Madagascar in that group where you would not go see – like, I would go see Toy Story with or without a kid. And I have for the last however many years.
I think I saw Toy Story 3 with like all my friends. Yeah.
Yeah. Same here. I went to a midnight screening of Toy Story there. Yeah. You know, I love that stuff. I probably wouldn't see Madagascar 3 without a group of kids to go with, but I didn't hate my life. It was fine. And you have movies like Rio, the last 2 Shrek movies, I think, are in this class where it's like and Shrek was a, man, they just really bombed that franchise. But just sitting through it is a real, real challenge. And I would think that as a parent, that's got to be – I mean, I'm sure I'll get my fair taste of this in a few years, but that's got to be one of the worst parts of parenthood is going to see Rio 2, which I saw the first Rio, and it's just one of the most boring movies I've ever seen. I can't imagine that any kid really enjoyed that movie, but – I think it's 2 things. You have to A, you have to sit through it, and then B, you have to listen to your kid talk about how good it is afterwards, you know. And you can't be like, you know what's a good movie? Shawshank Redemption, you know, 4-year-old, come on, get it together. You just have to kind of grin and bear it.
And you have to get snacks with your kids, you know. You gotta get the full popcorn and Cokes and candies.
Yeah. You know, it's funny. When I
rarely buy snacks at the
I never do. If I'm doing 2 movies, I might get a drink just because I'm going to be there for 4 or 5 hours. So I'll probably get – but if it's just one, I never get a thing. My family, unless we went to the dollar movie, we did not get concessions unless it was like a special occasion or something. That was like, hey, we're at the movies. I'm already spending – at that time, it was probably like I'm spending $25. Now it would be $60 just to go to the movies. Yeah. But, you know, I'll tell you, kid, this is funny. A few years ago, as I mentioned, I run a youth sports program. A few years ago, for our like end of season celebration for football season, I took everybody. I rented out a movie theater at the Rave around the corner from our house, like a 300 seat theater, and just said, "Okay, first 300 people that sign up, they can come for free." Like that was our that was my deal, and they got, you know, free popcorn and a drink and stuff like that. It was a really cool deal. But I had this family that the dad came up to me afterwards and said, and I knew 3 of his kids that were playing football that year. And he said, this is the first time that they've ever been to the movies. And I was like, are you serious? Like, I mean, these are, you know, 3rd and 4th grade kids. That's kind of crazy. Yeah. He has 8 kids. And so taking 8 kids to the movie is literally like $120, $150. And so
they
seriously had never been to a theater before, which is crazy to me, but that's kind of the world we live in.
Man, I remember going, I don't know if you ever did this. There was like a summer movie camp.
Yeah.
Growing up in like our local mall movie theater.
Yeah.
And I remember my mom and dad just dropping me off there when I was like very young, like early elementary school, like 2nd grade or something. And they would come pick me up after the movie, and they would show like Tom and Jerry the movie or something on the big screen.
Right.
And I would go with my sister, who's only a year older than me or 2 years older than me. But it's just crazy that, I don't know, I guess people just don't go to the movies, or their kids don't go anymore. That's crazy.
It's definitely a different world. I know plenty of kids that, like, their entire family, the only time they go to the movies is the dollar movie that's around the corner from our church and whatnot. And so, hey, you know, that I guess that leaves more room for like Redbox and stuff. But like, if I'm going to go hang out with kids, which I do like once every month or so, I've got a group of like kids that are fifth through maybe eighth grade, you know, and we'll go out and we'll do something. We'll go to Mavs game or something like that. And I try to make a point of, hey, we're going to go see movies because I love the movie. Obviously, I love the movies and I want to pass that on to the next generation. And it's stinking. It's tough for some of these kids to get out there and get exposed to good cinema. You know, I took like 15 kids to, me and two of the guys that are on my staff at work. We took 15 kids to go see Jurassic Park in 3D when it came out. And it was like, I mean, that was one of the best experiences I've ever had in a theater. Cause I love that movie. That's, you know, a magical moment in cinema and watching all these kids and some of them haven't been to the theater in a year, you know, and they're all, it's tough for the families for sure.
Have you caught any of these, classic cinema nights that Cinemark's been doing?
You know I haven't, I went and saw, what did I see? I went and saw Jaws a year or two ago, which was really cool. Cause I'm younger than that movie. So I've never seen it in theaters and that was a very cool experience. I love that they're doing that. If the Rave did that, because the Rave is so much closer to me than any other theater, and it's just, you know, with the kid and everything, it's just harder for me to get out and do stuff like that, especially when it's like a movie I own on Blu-ray or whatever. But if the Rave did that stuff, I would hit them more often. I love that Cinemark and like movie taverns and stuff like that have embraced that, because I think that is a much better trend than like remaking those movies. You know, I do not want to see a remake of Jaws, but if you put Jaws in a theater, yeah, I'll go see that. That's a great idea.
Yeah. They're doing it like every week now. It's not just a once a year, like on the anniversary of the movie type thing. They're doing it like a once a week. And, they were doing like Pulp Fiction. They had Back to the Future.
Yeah.
They had The Matrix, Fight Club, Christmas Vacation for the holidays.
Right.
So
yeah. Good. You know who's really good at that?
During Halloween, The Shining on the big screen. Oh, so great.
It's so cool. We pubbed this company before, but Alamo Drafthouse is so good at that because they pick really cool movies and kind of random stuff, and they have a different movie in that, you know, a different throwback movie like almost every day and like events to go along with it and stuff. It kills me that there's not an Alamo closer to us. Like I absolutely cannot drive to Richardson to go.
I read an article that they're opening a lot more throughout Dallas.
Good.
That was just the opening. They're just testing that one and then they're planning on more.
Yeah.
But I say we drive out to the Draft House for Anchorman 2. That's what we
should do. Yeah. Something like, for sure. Yeah.
That'd be awesome.
But they do so many cool things like that. So yeah, I'm a huge fan of that trend. I hope more theaters embrace that. Cause I think that's a great way to again expose new generations to great film, and it's a smart move on their part to like, because they sell tickets for like $5, you know, and but you're getting concessions and all that sort of stuff. So it's a great move for theaters to embrace that if they'll be smart enough to do it.
Yeah, they just opened a drive-in around, over by me too, which is
Have you been to a movie there at Coyote?
I haven't been there. My dad's a contractor, and his company was contracted to build it. So I do have a connection there, but I just haven't been down there yet.
Man, it's really cool. I've
heard it's great, though.
Yeah, we went like right before summer started. We saw, I think, Epic, which is not a very good movie, but you know, whatever. Epic and Iron Man 3. It's a good deal, and it's kind of a fun experience. I'm glad that is. It seems like it's doing really well. I have a lot of friends. And I know a lot of kids and like kids from like our youth group and stuff that go there on like a regular basis. So that's a cool thing. I'm a fan of seeing film in like different settings and stuff, and like you know, showings and screenings in the park, you know, things like that. It's the drive-in is a cool thing. Shout out to Coyote Drive-In. They're doing things right over there.
Totally. It's just interesting. It just reminded me when we're talking about the classic cinema.
Yeah.
Just like, it's like vintage movies are coming back. It's kind of a trendy thing for a drive-in, you know? Mm-hmm. Like, it's 2013. Mm-hmm. They're opening a drive-in? What?
Yeah. Yeah.
Like, it's just like, you know how vinyl records are really popular right now, you
right.
know?
Right.
Like, always, they sold more yeah. vinyl, like, last year than they did since 1979 or something.
Right.
Like, just
yeah.
randomly, you know?
Right.
It's cool, though. It's kind of, you look back and can appreciate these classic movies and the way things used to be, and it's cool. It's, mm-hmm. it's, I'm glad the trendy cinema has sort of faded. I think 3D is done.
Yeah.
For sure. Unless these big event films come out, like a Gravity or something.
Mm-hmm.
It's going to be really yeah. hard to convince people to pay extra for 3D, for me at least. I haven't paid extra for 3D since Gravity.
Yeah.
I don't think I've seen any movies since in 3D. Maybe
yeah.
out on accident I saw Thor, just because it was
right.
it wasn't advertised in 3D or something,
right.
but it
yeah.
was, so they did that extra money. I hate that.
Yeah, that's what happened to me.
What's advertised with, online isn't what's at the theater.
Right. Yeah, that's what happened to me with Frozen. I knew it was going to be 3D, but the time that we could make was a 3D showing, and so we just we'll do it. But
yeah,
I think it's going to get to the point, and I'm glad because I'm surprised to hear you say that because you've been a fan of 3D much more than I have.
I do enjoy it, and if the timing's right and the movie's right, I'll definitely prefer 3D.
Sure.
But I just don't, for a general audience, I think it's past the gimmick point, it's just
right.
okay, enough already, you know?
Yeah. No, I totally agree.
I heard Star Wars is going to be in 3D, though, the new one.
That's
so
fine.
Maybe that'll revive it. Maybe it'll take a year off, you know, or something.
Right. Yeah, I mean, it's fine as long as you're as long as you're using it for Gravity, you know, or Avatar yeah. or Hugo. I mean, if it actually makes it's an immersive part of the film, then I'm you know, okay, fine. But other than that, its only use is, hey kids, the Lego movie's in 3D. Now make your parents spend $5 extra per ticket to go to this, you know, 3D movie. I mean, it doesn't really serve a purpose.
What I much prefer, you know how you go to a say you're gonna go see Thor the Dark World, and you can either see it in 2D or 3D. Usually it's two separate theaters, a 2D mm-hmm. screen and a 3D screen.
Yeah.
It's like if they can just choose one, okay, this theater, it's going to be in 3D.
Sure.
So we're going to use that other theater to show a different movie. You
right.
know what I mean? Like,
sure.
we can't see Nebraska because no freaking theaters are playing it. Maybe if you weren't doubling up on 3D and 2D on every big
yeah.
budget, there would be more room for more movies, you know?
Right.
Like.
Yeah.
That's what I want. I want more. It's like every freaking theater around us is playing the same five movies.
Yeah. And that's the downside of the multiplex. Cause it used to be, I mean, when I was a kid in my general area, we had one theater at Northeast Mall and another theater at North Hills Mall, which doesn't exist anymore. And I think both theaters had six screens. And so you had to kind of, you know, there might be one or two movies that overlap, but for the most part, you had to say, oh, you know, Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles is playing at North Hills Mall, so we have to go there instead of Northeast Mall or whatever. But now they can dedicate six screens, you know, on the surface, hey, you have 30 screens. That means you can show 30 movies. Now you're probably only showing eight movies because
yeah.
we've got to dedicate, which I get. I wish that the bigger theaters would give me like two or three screens dedicated to smaller cinema and so that I could see Nebraska instead of whatever else, or we could have seen Inside Llewyn Davis this week or, you know, whatever. That would be excellent, but it's not the world we live in, Kent.
If you haven't seen freaking Carrie by now, probably right. good chance you're probably not going to see
yeah,
it in the theater.
You could probably go ahead and take that out.
It's been
yeah.
3 months. Ender's Game, you know, there's no
right.
there's no reason for those to still be out
right.
in the theater. That's all I'm saying.
The worst, dude, when I saw Out of the Furnace, I had to walk by a poster for Nebraska to go into the theater. And I was like, that's the movie I wanted to see. You can't advertise a movie that you're not going to put here. That's junk.
We're going to have to see Nebraska. It's going to have to be next week.
Yeah, we're going to have to get to it for sure.
It's going
to
– we got to get that –
Forte, baby.
Talk. Yeah.
That's right.
It's our boy.
Hey, ma'am, fam, question for you. Do you own a small business or are you a boss? Are you looking to hire awesome people, but you just can't find somebody to fill that role? Well, let me tell you about ZipRecruiter.com. With ZipRecruiter, you can post your job to 100-plus job sites all with one click. In fact, over 80% of jobs posted on ZipRecruiter get a qualified candidate in just 24 hours. Find out today why ZipRecruiter has been used by businesses of all sizes to find the most qualified job candidates with immediate results. That's why ZipRecruiter is different. Unlike other job sites, ZipRecruiter doesn't depend on candidates finding you. It finds them. Right now, you can post your jobs for free on ZipRecruiter by going to ZipRecruiter.com/mad. That's ZipRecruiter.com/mad. One more time, try it for free. Go to ZipRecruiter.com/mad. Thanks to ZipRecruiter for supporting this episode of the Mad About Movies podcast. Hey, what's up, Mam Fam? Kent here. And yes, if you're hearing from me, you know it's time to talk about Blue Apron. If you haven't tried out Blue Apron by now, what the heck are you even doing? Blue Apron is the number one fresh ingredient and recipe delivery service in the country. They deliver fresh meals straight to your door. All the food is fresh, it's sourced from local farms, and there's no wasted ingredients. I've been a Blue Apron subscriber for a long time now, and they have still, to this day, never let me down. There's tons of variety. Some featured upcoming meals include summer vegetable and egg paninis, soy glazed pork and rice cakes, skillet vegetable chili with cheddar drop biscuits, holy crap, and garlic butter shrimp and corn with green bean salad. So take it from me. Try out Blue Apron now. Go to blueapron.com/mad. That's blueapron.com/mad. Get three meals on us for free. Nothing goes better with a movie than dinner. So check out Blue Apron, blueapron.com/mad. Blue Apron, a better way to cook.
All right, let's move on, Brian.
All right.
Let's talk Out of the Furnace.
All right.
They haven't been able to find your brother. The people up in those hills, at their own greed of justice, but it does not include us.
This DeGroat is the worst. He haunts those mountains.
Please don't do anything for me. You don't want to go there.
We're going to get one shot at this guy. You ready for this?
All right. Let me just say this.
I like when you start like that. I like when you start.
You know it's going to be good.
Yeah, I'm excited.
It's going to... The first 30 minutes to 45, I wasn't paying that close of attention.
Sure.
Completely unwatchable. I mean, this movie, just horribly unwatchable. It's amazing that whoever wrote this, directed Scott Cooper, I think is his name, the director.
Yeah.
It's amazing that he even got Woody Harrelson and Christian Bale to turn the pages that far through the script. Maybe they were just – it was Now You See Me syndrome with Harrelson. Maybe he just wanted to see how bad it would end.
Yeah.
And not quite as bad in this case, but still pretty bad. Yeah, just this movie starts out so slow that it's just hard for it to ever gain traction and become anything. I think if they had started it, maybe done a 5-minute exposition in the middle and told us what had happened in the first 30 minutes, I would like it. Because in the middle to the end, it's watchable. It becomes something, but for me, it was a little too late. And I'll go into specifics later, but there's no really big performances here that wowed me. There are some that were laughable, which I'll talk about later.
Sure.
But give me your thoughts, Brian, because you chose this over Frozen to do the podcast. So I assume you had some good thoughts.
Yeah, I mean,
good argumentative points.
To be fair, Frozen hadn't started when you texted me and said, which one are we seeing? I mean, I hadn't seen Frozen yet. And also, I just felt like, I didn't think you and Richard would really enjoy Frozen, and I personally, I think Monsters University is like the worst episode that we've done because there's just nothing to really talk about when it comes to a kids movie. You know,
pretty popular episode.
That is,
just gotta say.
I'm glad it's popular. Yeah. That's like the one episode I didn't listen to because after we were done with it, I was like, I think I was terrible on that, so I'm just not gonna. Anyway, I don't dislike this movie. It sounds like as much as you did. I didn't mind the first hour. I'm kind of the reverse of you, Kent. I my problem is more that I felt like there was so much setup in the first hour that didn't really get paid off in the second hour. You know, I kept looking at my watch thinking, okay, we're getting to the turning point pretty soon. Like I'm not going to say I enjoyed, but I can't say that I appreciated, I guess, the way that Cooper, the director, kind of laid out the movie and the setting and the events and whatnot. And it's clearly pushing you towards, okay, it's going to be a pretty explosive finale. And then it just kind of peters out a little bit. An hour into this movie, I think any of us could have written down pretty much exactly how the movie was going to end, you know? And it's not like there's really a twist. And I don't know that this story lended itself to an actual twist, but there could have been a more enjoyable payoff at the end that I think would have made that first hour more bearable at the least, if not downright enjoyable to a degree. I thought, I'll say this. Have you seen Crazy Heart, Scott Cooper's first movie?
Yes, I love Crazy Heart.
I liked Crazy Heart. Crazy Heart's a better movie than this. Than Out of the Furnaces, but I do think that this is a much more complex movie than Crazy totally. Heart was. So I'm a fan of Scott Cooper, and I think that I'm going to compare him to a guy that we're going to see a movie from in a couple weeks that I think we're both very excited about. He reminds me of a grittier David O. Russell. Whose American Hustle looks like, if I had to pick, I would say that's the front runner for Best Picture. I really think it's going to blow people away when it hits in a couple weeks. Wolf of Wall Street looks like it's doing
Wolf
pretty.
Wall Street, it's going to be good. Llewyn Davis too. That's a sleeper.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
Hustle, I think, is going to have like a lot of appeal. That's going to hit some of those voters that aren't going to get Gravity. That aren't going to get.
Oh, Spike
the
Jones.
4-hour runtime of
another Dark Horse.
Wall Street. I would not. I mean, I'm excited to see her. Her is gonna get the shaft. I think it's gonna be so. It's such a strange premise. I don't think that the old white viewers are gonna really enjoy it.
I don't know.
It
won like some New York's critics' best picture or something award. I don't know.
That's a different.
I don't know if that means anything.
That's a different group of guys. Then anyway. But back to my point being, I think David O. Russell is very, very good at getting great performances out of his actors. And I don't think that he, to this point, has been good necessarily at making a great movie. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
He gets, I mean, great performances. The Fighter got Christian Bale an Oscar, and Wahlberg, I think, got nominated, or if he didn't, he should have been. I mean, he gets great performances out of those guys. Silver Linings Playbook Bradley Cooper gives the performance that you knew that he was capable of in that movie. So I think David O. Russell is great at doing that. I don't know that. I think his performances in the movies outdo the actual movies themselves. So I kind of think that's where Cooper's at as well. So my point being, this is not a great movie. It's not one that I would recommend people run out and see because it's pretty dark and gritty. But he's two movies in. He got an Oscar for Jeff Bridges. Nobody from this is going to get nominated, but Christian Bale is pretty good. Casey Affleck is really good in a very limited role. I think that this is a guy who is capable of making a great movie, and it may be two or three more movies down the line before he gets to that. I just hope he keeps getting opportunities because I see a lot of good in what he's doing. And I really do think he's capable of making an absolutely tremendous film. So I guess what I'm saying is I like that he took a step away from Crazy Heart, which was a very good movie and very successful for what it was, but it's pretty easy to do if you have the right performer, which he did. This is a much tougher task and it doesn't really come together as well as you might hope, but I think it shows signs of maturity that he's trying to move in that direction. So that was very long-winded.
Did this movie to you just feel like a B movie?
Yeah,
it's to me, I just couldn't get the feeling out of my mind, or the portrayal of the actors was just like nobody was taking it serious.
I didn't get that.
Not so taking it serious, but just like you could tell that they were doing this and they had another job that they were really working on, you know, like,
yeah,
I don't know.
I can see that.
Like they were doing this on the weekends and they were working on another movie during the week or something. It just felt like every person in it was just, I don't know. It didn't feel like any person in this felt like it had any potential.
Yeah, I can see that. I mean, it seemed like, look, we see movies like this every year where you assemble an incredible cast and you have a hot director. And then you get there and you just realize, this isn't going to be as good as everybody, it isn't going to be as good as we thought it was going to be. And that's kind of a letdown. I thought Christian Bale was really good. I just think Christian Bale's not really he doesn't have a dynamic charisma that some other actors have. And that's okay. I don't particularly think that Daniel Day-Lewis has a dynamic charisma either, but he's, you know, one of the best actors in the world. So I think Christian Bale is a phenomenal actor. I think that maybe this movie would have required, I don't want to just keep saying Jeff Bridges because I don't know that he's even right for this role, but you know, a guy like that who kind of exudes a charisma that would make this a more enjoyable film. It did. So I can't say that from the performance standpoint, Kent, but I will say it did kind of feel like it felt like the B-side to a Coen Brothers movie.
Yeah.
A lot of times. It felt the Coens like started writing this and then were like, I don't really see where this is going. And they just like handed it off to somebody else who finished it and made it into a movie. And so it's fine, but it doesn't have the comedy of a Coen Brothers movie, but it also doesn't have the wit of a Coen Brothers movie. It reminded me a lot of, have you ever seen that movie, A Simple Plan? That came out in like the late 90s with Bill Paxton.
Yes.
It kind of reminded me of that, except a little, not quite as dark, but that just seemed like such a Coen Brothers movie. And then it just kind of, it exists, I guess. So that was
I'm glad you said that. I said B movie because I meant like a movie you would see before a real movie.
Sure. Yeah.
Like if they showed me this, and then immediately after this, I saw Llewyn Davis like in the same theater,
right?
With like some fake trailers in between.
Yeah.
Tropic Thunder style. That would have been awesome.
And
this movie would have been a lot better.
Sure.
But it just felt like a filler. This movie feels like a filler movie. It's like bridging the gap between the big budget, Thanksgiving releases of the world, the Gravities, if you will, and the Christmas movies. It's like, this movie is the perfect one for this week. You know, it's just got some Oscar caliber actors in it, not necessarily performances, but has some stigma attached to it. This movie probably cost $5 million to make or something.
It's 20 million, 22 million.
Wow.
But that's partly because the cast has got to be making a lot of money.
Unless you're paying like Woody Harrelson $10 million.
Sure.
I don't see how this movie cost that. 20 million. Wow.
Yeah. Well, I mean,
there's
they
no
shot
way it's
on location.
Make 20 million.
That ups your price. If you're shooting, I don't know where they're shooting. I mean, it's based in like the Pittsburgh Appalachian area, but
sure,
I don't think much of this at all was done on a set. So that's, that adds to it. It does seem like at $22 million does seem steep. So I would imagine if I had to guess, I would say that the actors didn't take their price tag down too much to be in the movie.
Well, I know you like the intro and the outro, Brian. Pearl Jam.
I did. I love that. And a new version. Yes. That's like my second favorite Pearl Jam song too. So that was awesome.
Yeah.
I enjoyed that quite a bit.
I knew right when they played it at the beginning, I was like, oh, they're going to end this movie with it too.
Yeah.
I was just waiting for the guitar riff to come in at the end.
Yeah.
And it did.
It was.
It
did.
Very predictable.
It was good. Yeah, it was. Look, it's not a great movie by any stretch of the imagination. I think I probably liked it a little bit more than you did, but I can't say that
let me be clear. The first act It was unwatchable to me. That's it.
Sure.
The rest of the movie was fine. And, you know, if I had only seen that, I probably would have liked it. It just took so long for me to get to the point where I didn't want to look at my watch. It took so long for me to get to the point where I was like, all right, now the story can begin. Now the movie is going to get going. I didn't know if it was what it was about. First of all, I didn't look into the plot synopsis before I went to the movie or anything. So I had no idea what it was about. It's called Out of the Furnace. So it could be about pretty much anything. Leaves it pretty much open for anything. So I didn't know if it was, I was like, okay, it's about prison. It's Christian Bale's getting out of prison.
Right.
Cool. So that makes sense. Out of the furnace. Okay. The jail's the furnace. Cool. So he gets out like immediately. And then it's about boxing. So I was like, oh, okay. It's a boxing movie. It's like a warrior or the fighter or something.
Right.
Casey Affleck's like, no, it's not about fighting anymore. And then the, Woody Harrelson, spoiler alert coming up now for Out of the Furnace. Woody Harrelson, when he murders, Affleck and everybody, I was like, okay, now the movie's going to start. Okay. You know, that's how I felt. And that point came a good 45 to an hour in.
Yeah.
I felt like if that point had come, if he had killed off Affleck in the verse 30, this movie's a whole grade letter higher to me.
Okay. Sure.
It's not the worst movie I've seen of the year. It reminded me of The Place Beyond the Pines.
Yeah, that's a fair.
And I think A Place Beyond the Pines is immensely better, entertaining wise, with the heist scenes and all that. Like, I feel like
that third act of that Place Behind the Beyond the Pines is such a letdown.
It's this movie's first act, is what it is.
Yeah, totally.
But if those movies had been switched, like if Place Beyond the Pines had come out like now, and this movie had come out over the spring, it would have been perfect.
Yeah,
I would have probably been really psyched about Place Beyond the Pines had it come out right now.
Right.
You know, it'd have been like, could it get nominated? Gosling was pretty good. We'd never seen Bradley Cooper in a role like this.
Right.
You know, it would have been more effective to be released here, but it's not. So anything that you disliked about this?
Yeah, we should talk about I want to
talk about Forrest Whitaker.
Yeah, I was going to say, we should talk about the performances. Because, like I said, I think Bale's pretty good. Affleck is I really like Bale, so I'm maybe a little biased, but I thought he did a really good job with a minimal dialogue. You know, I mean, he did solid stuff, just, you know, emoting without talking and stuff. Affleck was pretty good, but he's only in the movie for a few minutes. We all love American Treasure Woody Harrelson. And I'm not going to say that he's bad in this, but the character is poorly designed.
His mouth was half full of something.
Yeah.
He was inaudible half the time.
Yeah, you can't understand him. And I know that's part of the bit because he's a hillbilly and that's supposed to be what he's doing. But you could make it to where you could understand him. That would be acceptable.
Yeah.
It's a strange role for him. Again, just plays into the theories we have about him because I wish I could had a great analogy, but it seems like a role that somebody who doesn't already have his chops as a really good actor would take, because it's kind of a desperate role in a way, and he's above that. Paul Dano maybe, or like a comedic actor who's trying to show that he can play serious, you know, or something like that. Anyway, not a great role for him, and you can't say that it's really a great performance partly because of that. But as you mentioned, dude, Forrest Whitaker.
I literally laughed out loud when he started talking.
My gosh.
I thought he was making fun of Christian Bale's Batman voice for a second. I was like, oh, he's making fun. Oh, wait, this is a movie. Oh. I'm watching a movie right now. He's really doing this voice.
Jeez, man.
He was doing the Robert Downey Jr. from Tropic Thunder. That was the voice.
Uh-huh, yeah.
I'm just a dude disguised as another dude.
Right.
It was like, why not just speak normal, Forrest Whitaker? Like, that's what I mean by a filler movie. Like, you can tell he's like, all right, I've already done The Butler this year. Got some other stuff, you know, sprinkling out. You know, I'll just go for something different in this movie. I'll do a crazy accent. How about that? Gosh, don't do it. It ruined the movie. It really was.
It's a blessing for this movie that he's only in the movie for about 5 or 6 minutes, because otherwise there's I don't know that I could have sat through. I mean, it's really bad. And my question is this: are we sure that Forrest Whitaker is a good actor?
No, I'm not. I've been unsure since Fast Times at Ridgemont High.
Okay,
it's been quite a while for me.
I mean, I know he has an Oscar, and I haven't seen The Butler. Apparently, he's really good in that. But man, I'm looking at his IMDb, and it's
Vantage Point was pretty good.
You know, he's pretty good in Panic Room, which is an underrated.
That is. He's got a very small role in that, though, too.
Yeah, I mean, he's okay in that, and I don't know. I guess he was good in Last King of Scotland. I don't know that that was worth an Oscar. He was really good on The Shield for a season, but, man, there's a lot of really bad movies on his resume, and I don't know that I've ever seen him elevate the material to a higher level. You know what I mean? Like, I mean, I don't know, dude. I don't think that he's... This movie was like that realization of, oh, if Forrest Whitaker's in this, that's good, because he's a good actor. And then, like, maybe not. I don't know that he's a good actor at all, to be quite honest with you.
Right. Zoe Saldana, I love her.
I do, too.
Not quite a great role for her.
Yeah. It's
very limited... Yeah. Not a lot of opportunity for her to make anything of it here, but
sure.
I like her. She's gorgeous.
Right.
Might be number one most gorgeous female out there.
Okay.
Just putting that out there. So yeah, a lot. There's star power in this movie. Never really got anything sad that there's not one glaring performance that was like, man, that was awesome. You know,
right.
Casey Affleck was pretty good, but he's only in the movie for, less than 2/3 of it. What else? I like the drug house scene.
Yeah.
With Harrelson was in the next room when Bale went in. I feel like that's what I'm saying. There are so many little good suspenseful moments in the second half.
Right. And but, I think that's an example of what I said earlier of Cooper is going to be, I think he's going to make a great movie eventually. Cause there are two or three scenes in this that are incredibly well staged. And then they just don't quite pop the way that you want them to. And I think that's an experience. I mean, this really is only his second movie. So I think he's got the right sensibilities. I just don't know that he knows how to execute it at this point.
Brian Gill, what's your grade for Out of the Furnace?
I'm going to go with a straight B. Kent, how about you?
I'm going to go B-.
Yeah. I can
to a C++, like right in between a B and C is where it is to me.
Yeah. I may end up coming down when I put my final list together at the end of the year. This is one that's definitely a candidate to drop, like the more I think about it. So
totally.
I can buy that.
Bible. All right. Good stuff. Let's move on. And let's do Weekly Recommends.
All right.
Weekly Recommends.
Okay, Brian. Hit us with your recommend.
So I was going to do Frozen, but we talked about that earlier in the movie. So go see Frozen. It's really fun. And especially if you have kids or you're an old married person like me, I think you'll definitely enjoy it. But for my official weekly recommend, I'm going to pick a TV show that I just caught up on yesterday and today. You may have seen it. It piloted in November, so we didn't get to talk about it on our TV pilot episode. But it's a show called Almost Human on Fox with Mr. Carl Urban who we've talked about before, and Michael Ealy. It's got a very. It's I think J.J. Abrams is involved with it at some level, and it's got a very Philip K. Dick feel to it, very similar to. You know, Minority Report and Blade Runner and all that sort of stuff. It hasn't reached its potential from a storytelling perspective. Kid, did you ever see the show Fringe?
No, I haven't.
Okay. Fringe, at some point, will be a weekly recommend. I really enjoyed that show. I watched the first 3 seasons. It's excellent. Great storytelling on that show. This show doesn't quite have that down yet. I think that it's going to get to it at some point, But for right now, for the moment, the reason I watch is very similar to The Blacklist. I watch The Blacklist because of Spader. If they killed off Spader tomorrow, I would never watch another episode of the show. The chemistry between Carl Urban and Michael Ealy is outstanding. Like, it's a lot of fun to watch them work together and kind of work against each other. The bit is, it's the future. Carl Urban is a human, obviously. He's a cop. And it's like, I don't know, 40 years in the future or something. And Michael Ealy is artificial intelligence, and it's his partner. And, you know, Carl Urban is kind of the standard grumpy old guy who doesn't like technology. And so he's got a partner with this walking toaster that he's got to figure out how to work with and stuff. But they have a really good relationship. They do some really cool stuff on the show. They work well together. Both on the show, like, their characters work well together, and they work well together as actors. There's a lot of interesting supporters. Minka Kelly from Friday Night Lights and Lily Taylor. And anyway, there's a lot of good stuff going on. I can't tell you, can't definitively, that it's going to end up being a great show, but it's really enjoyable, and it's got the potential, I think, to bump up to be a very good sci-fi show, which is kind of rare, honestly. So Almost Human is my pick of the week.
Nice. I have seen it. I've watched almost all the episodes.
Are you enjoying your,
I'm enjoying
your
it
journey?
Sweet. Immensely. It's definitely it would have been my favorite show if it had been in the fall pilots episode,
yeah,
probably.
I think I'm
it's
with
better
you
than S.H.I.E.L.D. It is.
It is. Don't, it's totally better. Yeah. I think this and Sleepy Hollow, which is, I still can't believe that I'm watching Sleepy Hollow, but man, that's a fun show. So this fits quite well with it, I think.
Yeah, I love Carl Urban. I think I've made that clear on this show a lot of times in the past.
Right.
But man, the guy's awesome.
This is a great cross between Dread, which I don't like. I didn't like that movie very much, but I know you did. But he was cool.
I love that.
In the movie. It's a good cross for him personally. Like, it's a good cross for him between Dread and Bones McCoy on Star Trek.
Right.
It's a good balance between those two characters, and he's really good at what he does. And so I enjoy it a lot. I'm glad you're watching it as well.
Sweet, good recommend. Thanks, Brian. I'm gonna recommend a episode of a show.
Okay.
I'm gonna recommend the Christmas episodes of The Office.
Yeah.
This week,
yeah.
I know you've talked about them before, but.
Yep.
Specifically, Classy Christmas and A Benihana Christmas.
Yeah.
Great, great, awesome stuff. If you don't even like The Office, just watch the Christmas episodes because they're good on their own.
Yeah.
And you don't really need to know any storyline for those. But man, such a great tradition to around Christmas. It's Christmas time right now. If you're listening to this in the summer or spring or whatever, when we're recording this, so We do love Christmas, but we don't talk about it in like July. Just
right.
Making that clear.
Yeah.
I do like going out every year or sitting down and watching like old Christmas movies and TV shows and the Charlie Brown Christmas and the whole nine yards. I do enjoy that every year. I can appreciate a good Christmas movie.
Sure.
Or TV show.
Yeah. Same here. I'm with you. I watch all the Office Christmases the weekend after Thanksgiving. My wife and I like decorate the house and all that stuff, and we always watch all those. You know what's underrated on this spectrum of Office Christmases is the last one, the one with Dwight as the what's it called? Can't remember the weird Pennsylvania
Dwight Christmas.
Yeah. That's a strong.
Where he's the German.
Yeah, I can't
Santa
remember what
Claus.
The guy's name is. Yeah, but strong episode.
Man, such a great show. And the last season, I got so used to not seeing Michael. I'm so glad I can go back and watch episodes with Michael because it's such an immensely better show with Mr. Michael Scott. It just is. So go back, watch a Benihana Christmas. Just the cold open is great with Dwight and a dead goose.
Yeah.
So
one of my favorite lines on that episode and really in the whole show is when Andy talks him into going and he walks out of the office and he's just so dejected and he says, Jim, Ryan, Dwight, let's go. Where are we going? Asian Hooters.
Yeah. Classic.
Great line. Great recommend. Love those.
Awesome.
Love
Thank you. So yeah. Thank you, sir. Well, Brian Gill, let me ask you this. Where can I find you online?
You can find me on Twitter at bgill12, or you can find my writing at canbabiesdrinkredbull.com. Kent, where might I find you?
You can find me on Twitter at Kent Garrison. And you can find our show on the internet at madaboutmoviespodcast.com. Find all our episodes on there. Download them, stream them, and share them. Find weekly recommends on there and contact the show on there as well. And be sure to leave a 5-star review on iTunes. I noticed we've gotten a couple more in the past few weeks, so that's awesome. We'll shout you out in the next couple weeks. So
we will. We love that stuff. Keep it coming, guys. Tell your friends. We want to share the joy.
By the way, man, movie season is beginning again. The next 3 weeks are going to be crazy.
Yeah, dude. So we got like 300 episodes to record in the next couple weeks.
Stay tuned to the website in the next few weeks.
Yeah,
for a lot of content. Maybe some bonus episodes around Christmas morning. Who knows?
Yeah.
But on that note, until next time, we will see you at the cinema.
Goodbye.
Goodbye.